tales for dark nights.
Part 1. Operation Stingray is in effect. I have to make this quick. I don't have much time. None of us do. I'm going to be leaving out some details and changing others. I have no way of knowing which of you reading this is already working for them. In fact, you don't know if you are either. Christ, I'm getting ahead of myself. Let me start from the beginning. I've known Brian since college. We lived on the same floor freshman year and had some intense Call of Duty battles while everyone else was out improving their social skills. Yeah, he was an asshole. But he was my kind of asshole, and I took a liking to him. He was a computer science major, and I was in music school. And to this day, I don't know a damn thing about computers, but I'd get a kick out of listening to him talk about that stuff. He did a lot of black hat hacking and would constantly make vague references to bizarre documents and schematics he would pull off of government computers. And to me, they sounded ridiculous. Bioengineered doomsday viruses, underwater experimentation labs, laser cannons in space. You know, I was convinced he was making it all up. After graduation, we both stayed in the city, but we weren't able to see each other much due to our respective work commitments. We'd get together every few months or so, and he'd always have some new piece of government conspiracy meat for us to chew on. We got drinks over the summer, and he told me he was looking into something major, something called Operation Stingray. A serious security, even around the most innocuous references to it. A very, very big deal, he assured me. You know, I nodded and challenged him to some drunken team fortress.
Can't tonight, man. But when I blow the lid off this thing, I'm gonna pyro your ass like the old days.
Sure thing, Brian. Let me know how that works out for you. That was the last I'd heard from him for months. Then, out of the blue one night, he texted me. Brian,
need to talk. Meet me at tomorrow at noon. Don't mention this to anyone.
Me? Sure, man. Everything okay? Brian?
I don't know. Just please don't be late.
I chuckled. Always so dramatic. Lindsay rolled over in bed.
What's up, hon?
Nothing, babe. Just Brian being Brian again. Go back to sleep. I got to the restaurant a few minutes early to snag a table before the lunch rush. Across the street, there was a small protest going on outside of one of the big downtown banks.
Money for schools, not for bonuses. Money for schools, not for bonuses. Money for schools, not for bonuses.
They chanted. Brian staggered in. Weak old scruff, pale and puffy skin, bloodshot eyes, sweat. I'd seen him like that a few times in college, but Christ, we're supposed to be adults by now. He clutched a crumpled manila envelope with both hands. Morning, beautiful, I said.
Thanks for coming, man. I didn't know who else to call. I'm sorry.
Dude, relax. Sit down. He glanced around the restaurant and took his seat. He didn't let go of the envelope.
Were you followed?
Listen to you.
Were you followed?
Man, are you serious? Look, we can pretend to be spies, but only so long as you don't actually creep me out. He reached into the envelope and pulled out a small white pill. He held it out to me.
What the hell is that?
Just take it.
Dude, I am not going to get fucked up with you in a crowded restaurant in the middle of the day.
It's just a vitamin. Take it.
Since when did you become such a health nut?
Just fucking take it, man. Please.
His eyes were wild and desperate, and they evaporated any trace of a smile from my face.
Okay, chill.
I took the pill and swallowed it. Happy? He visibly relaxed and reached into the envelope again. He removed a stack of papers and placed them on the table.
I'll try to go over what I can. I don't know how much time we'll have, but everything you need to know is right in here.
Seriously, Brian, are you going to tell me what I just swallowed?
It started about a year ago. I was cracking some DOD contractors for shits and giggles, and I kept seeing the word Stingray being mentioned. Cryptic shit like top secret memos that just said Stingray is a go, stuff like that. I was curious, so I poked around for leads. It wasn't a lot to go on, but there were a few breadcrumbs that led to a facility out in the desert in bumblefuck Utah. DRS-117, they called it. Tiny place, staff of a couple dozen with bullshit names like Jane Smith, John White, etc. Everything about this place was classified. And I mean everything. The fucking cafeteria budget was redacted.
Riveting. You really outdone yourself this time, man.
Shut up and listen. The place was a black hole. No info came out of there at all, save for a few emails sent to the DOD heads that said, "The project is proceeding on schedule." I poked around for a while, and eventually I pulled the name of an applicant they were interested in working with at DRS-117. Some big-shot neuroscientist out of Stanford. A few days after I saw his name mentioned, there was a news report that said he died in a car accident in the Redwoods. A few days after that, a memo made the rounds saying that the new 117 project member is proving to be a valuable resource to Stingray's development.
A smiling waiter walked up to our table.
"Are you gentlemen ready to order?"
"I think we'll need a few minutes," I said.
"Not a problem. Take your time."
The waiter lingered for a second. His mouth was smiling, but his eyes seemed to be studying us. He left and Brian continued.
"The Stanford guy was a big name in his field. He specialized in developing systems that could link the human brain with computer interfaces. His early work eventually led to the development of some new next-gen prosthetics."
He leaned in and his voice dropped to a low whisper.
"Here's the kicker. At the time of his death, he was working on a method for wirelessly transmitting electrical signals into the brain to stimulate neural impulses. Massively complex stuff. But the gist is that his system could project images, sounds, and sensations directly into the brain from a computer. Not just that, but depending on what part of the brain you targeted, it could create emotions, memories, even thoughts themselves out of thin air. His colleagues thought he'd lost his shit, but he maintained that the system would someday revolutionize mental health treatment. He thought he'd be able to diagnose specific malfunctions in an individual's thinking and fix them with a laptop. Of course, after the accident, no one was able to locate any of his research. His hard drives had been erased, and his notes were missing from the lab."
I rubbed my eyes. I wasn't nearly drunk enough to be listening to this shit, and I was starting to get a headache. "Man, not to sound uninterested, but let's go ahead and order already. I'm not feeling so hot right now."
"Try to focus,"
he said.
"I knew I needed to get more info, so I looked for a weak link in the communication chain. I found the information choke point, the one guy who was the direct liaison between 117 and the Defense Department. Everything went through him. Over a few months, I got into every piece of computerized electronics this guy touched, and I waited. Yeah, the guy was careful, very careful. It took a while, but eventually he slipped. He left an unencrypted video file on his laptop without password protection one night, and I snatched it up. When I watched it, here, see for yourself."
He tapped his phone and handed it to me. The screen showed a large white room with a chimpanzee sitting in the middle eating from a bowl of fruit. Off to the side, a man stood at a computer console. He was facing the camera. "Stingray experimental test subject number 117-011. Simple motor functions." He tapped on the keyboard and the chimp stopped eating. He stopped moving at all, actually. It sat there, completely motionless, like a doll. "Right arm," the man said as he tapped a command on the keyboard. The chimp raised its right arm. "Stand." The chimp stood up. "Take 7 steps to your left." The chimp did so. The video cut out and started up again, apparently at a later date. The same setup as before. "Experimental test subject number 117-011. Emotional regulation." He tapped on the keyboard and said, "Anger." The chimp immediately flung the fruit across the room and launched into an awful screaming rage. It rushed at the man and raised its arms to strike him.
"Sadness."
The chimp collapsed onto the floor and moaned. It curled into a ball and pressed its face into its knees.
"Fear."
The chimp screeched and scrambled into a corner of the room, wide-eyed and shaking. Again, the video cut out. When it restarted, the man stared into the camera without speaking for a long silence.
Experimental test subject number 117-011. Self-preservation override.
The man tapped away on his keyboard, then paused for a moment, looking at the chimp. His finger hovered over a key. He sighed and pressed it. The chimp went motionless for a second and then raised its hands to its face. The chimp sat there quietly as it tore its own eyes out. The man looked into the camera.
Based on these results, I recommend moving into phase 2 immediately.
The video went black.
What the fuck did you just show me?
That's not even the half of it, Brian said.
Pretty soon, after I saw that video, I started talking with Lafarge. And that's when things really got weird.
The waiter stepped up to the table again. Brian waved him off.
We still need a few minutes.
I'm sorry, sir, but there's a phone call for you.
Brian frowned.
It must be Lafarge. I told him I was meeting you. Wait here.
Brian and the waiter stepped into the back of the restaurant, and I sat there rubbing my temples. I wasn't in the mood to listen to conspiracy fantasies, and now it looked like I was getting a migraine. I decided I was going to excuse myself when he got back. Conspiracy games aren't fun when you have a splitting headache. I looked out the window at the protest. A waifish girl with blonde dreadlocks and a knit sweater was reciting slam poetry about the evils of greed. The ineffectiveness of it all would be comical if it wasn't so sad. The waiter walked by again and I touched him on the arm. Listen, I'm afraid I'm not feeling well and I have to step out. Please tell my friend I'm sorry and I'll get in touch with him later in the week.
Not a problem, sir. Will your friend be arriving soon?
No, I mean my friend who was just here, the one you took back for the phone call. The waiter looked puzzled.
I'm sorry, sir. I'm not sure what you mean.
What? Why?
You've been sitting here by yourself since you arrived.
I looked at him. Was this kid messing with me? That's not funny, I said. I stood up and walked to the back of the restaurant.
Brian. Hey, Brian, are you back here?
I turned down the small hallway that held the phone in the restrooms. It was empty. I checked the men's room. Nothing. I walked back to the front of the restaurant.
Okay, kid, cut it out.
Where's my friend?
I'm sorry, sir. I don't know who you're referring to.
I felt eyes on me and I looked around. The rest of the waitstaff were all standing perfectly still, staring at me with blank expressions. The waiter stepped towards me.
But there is a phone call for you. Please follow me to the back.
The waitstaff advanced on me.
There was a thunderous crash as a brick smashed through the plate glass window at the front of the restaurant.
I looked out the hole and saw that the peaceful little protest had turned savage. Protesters were smashing windows and cars and attacking passerbys. The poetry girl was standing in the middle of the street, staring into the restaurant with a crazed grin. We locked eyes for a moment before a police cruiser smashed into her, sending her flying in a cloud of red mist. The restaurant erupted into chaos. Diners attempted to flee, knocking the waitstaff aside. I grabbed Brian's manila envelope from the table and jumped out of the open window. Police officers flooded the scene. They fired tear gas and beat the protesters bloody with batons. But it was all wrong. They came too quickly, almost immediately, as soon as the protest had turned violent. As though they were waiting for it to happen.
I sprinted home and bounded up the stairs to my apartment. I flung the door open. Lindsay was slicing tomatoes in the kitchen and she gasped when I burst into the room. I slammed the door behind me and locked it.
Jesus, honey, is everything all right?
I don't know. We have to call the cops. Something happened to Brian.
What? What happened?
He just disappeared. He went to get a phone call and then the waiter's...
My head was throbbing and I collapsed onto the couch. Lindsay ran to me.
Honey, calm down. Just breathe. Everything's gonna be fine, okay? Just breathe.
I sat up and she stood behind the couch. Her hand on my back made me feel better and I relaxed a little.
You're right. I just need to think.
I don't even know where to begin.
I looked down at the manila envelope in my hand. I opened it and saw another, smaller envelope inside. I pulled it out and saw that the words,
"If anything happens to me,"
were written on the front.
"Just calm down,"
Lindsay said, rubbing my shoulder gently.
"Just calm down. Whatever it is, we're gonna figure it out."
I touched her hand and looked up at a reflection in the TV screen. "Thank you," I said, smiling. I looked back down at the envelope. I opened it and pulled out a stack of papers. On the top, there was one with a single word written in black marker.
"Run."
I looked up at Lindsay's reflection. She was raising the knife above her head, ready to plunge it into my back.
Chilling tales for dark nights.